Good morning. Before we begin, I would like to acknowledge that we meet and learn from each other today on country. I'm at the State Library of New South Wales and I'm coming to you from Gadigal land. This comparatively young library sits on one of the world's great ancient libraries, a rich repository of oral tradition, and I pay my sincere respects to elders past, present and emerging. And of course, I extend that respect to any Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders who may be with us here today. Welcome. My name is Rachel Franks and I'm the coordinator of scholarship here at the library. And I'm pleased to see you all again for another scholar talk. We have a few people here on site in real life, which is lovely. And we have a really huge crowd joining us online. So welcome from wherever you are. Today, it's a real treat, as it always is, to introduce one of the library's fellows. Dr. Jared Hall was a David Scott Mitchell Fellow here at the library back in 2020, which seems like a very long time ago now. He is a program manager at the University of New South Wales, where he's undertaking some postdoctoral work. And his new book, Visions of Nature, will be out at the end of this year or early next from the University of California Press. So we don't like to put too much pressure on our fellows here at the library, but we do like a book. So you'll find out more about Jared's work when that book comes out. If you're here in the Metcalf Auditorium and you have a question for Jared after his presentation today, just put your hand up and call out your question. Because we are recording, I will repeat your question so that we can capture that in the audio. And if you are at home or work or somewhere else, just use the chat feature on Zoom. That would be terrific. And we'll get to those questions at the end. For now, here's Jared with his scholar talk for February 2021.
Good morning, everyone, and thanks, Rachel, for your introduction and for your acknowledgement of country. I too wish to acknowledge that I'm standing and speaking today from Gadigal country and that my work for this talk was done on the lands of the Gadigal, Bedigal, Cammeraygal and Darug peoples. Before I start in earnest, I also want to quickly thank Rachel and all the staff at the library for their assistance over the past year. It's been a challenging and frustrating year for many reasons, but I'm sure that I speak for all those who use the library and its collections when I say that I'm deeply appreciative of all the work you've done to make sure that our work can continue. Finally, I also need to thank the library for running such an incredible fellowship program. Speaking from my position as an early career historian, my time as a Mitchell Fellow has been nothing short of transformative. The support of the library has allowed me to frame and develop my thinking on the environmental history of colonial geology and begin a new series of conversations that should continue throughout the next stage of my career. I'm extremely grateful for the opportunities that the library has afforded me over the past 12 months, and I hope I can begin to hold up my end of the bargain today in this talk and in the next few years as the results of my Mitchell Fellowship begin to appear as journal articles, chapters, and books. Okay, now to my talk, Landscaping Eastern Australia Through the Colonial Survey. For the first century of settlement in the Antipodes, the depths of the colonial earth defied comprehension. Writing toward the end of his career in 1867, the colony's first sustained geological thinker, William Clark, referred to his life's work in the valleys, mountains, and plains of Eastern Australia as membra disjecta, scattered fragments which future geologists might work into some more form of complete natural knowledge. About a decade after this, Charles Wilkinson, 45 years Clark's junior, was installed at the helm of the newly established Geological Survey of New South Wales, a body which Clark hoped would finally work out the intricacies of Australian geology even if it would take the work of many hands and last into the middle of the next century at least. Eastern Australia was surely vast. Clark conducted fieldwork in a 3,000-kilometre arc from Tasmania in the south to Moreton Bay in the north, and wrote authoritatively about an even greater expanse of territory. But the geological project was complicated by more than just distance. Geological mapping advanced unevenly in Australia, and surveys never fully captured colonial conditions. Instead, as settlers used extant topographic knowledge to reshape environments, geologists returned to the field again and again to renew the connections between the extraction of resources and their own incomplete intellectual project. Clark arrived in New South Wales in the late 1830s and immediately set about making sense of what he enthusiastically called a new earth for geology. Along with other surveyors and officials such as Wilkinson, Thomas Mitchell, and Samuel Stutchbury, Clark played an important role in wrestling with the changing faces of this new earth and gradually making it known. These figures worked at the pressing edge of a scramble for territory that combined the 18th century agricultural impetus of what the historian John Weaver has called the Great Land Rush with the intensive pastoral and extractive priorities of the mid-19th century. Geologists were uniquely equipped to adjudicate between these possible uses because they were practitioners of the ultimate cosmopolitan science. In other words, figures like Clark provided for the ordering, exploitation, and extraction of the materials of the terrestrial globe. In assessing the country, writing reports, and publishing material for popular consumption, geologists fueled a rush for Antipodean Earth. Traditionally, the history of this geological project in Australia has been folded into a story about colonial surveying that begins with the arrival of the first Surveyor General, Augustus Ault, in 1788. On one level, this is fair enough. The project of delineating space, recording boundaries, placing infrastructure, and mapping surface resources, what the late historian of science Anne Moyle called keeping the records of a moving frontier, was obviously a precursor to colonial geology. But on another level, what Clark was involved in is in a different matter entirely. Reading the landscape as Thomas Mitchell did, as a former soldier engaged in cartographic or cadastral survey, and as Clark did, as a thinker of undergrounds and past worlds, are utterly different. What I've learned while looking into the records of those who made sense of Earth's archive, and especially in the past year as the Mitchell Fellow, is that we need a new history of colonial geology that proceeds from this fact. Now, the argument that I'm interested in starting today, or the conversation, is about the difference between topography and stratigraphy. Historically, these two branches of the survey are insufficiently distinguished, despite the fact that officials asked quite different questions based on whether they were investigating surfaces or underworlds. In colonial contexts too, exploration on the horizontal plane involved much higher degrees of intercultural contact and reliance. Indeed, Mitchell seems at times in his three expeditions to be much more interested in anthropological observations than environmental ones. Geological study drew upon the information that accumulated during topographic expeditions, and geologists occasionally made use of Indigenous informants and information. But crucially, stratigraphy asked scientists to think beyond human scales. Not only has this confusion between topographic and stratigraphic surveys meant that we've been slow as historians to decide on exactly what kind of settler colonial occupation each project produced, but it means that we have also been able to unable to identify what forms of knowledge production remained consistent between both types of surveying and which ones were unique. This leads me to my second concern today, which is the transfer between Indigenous and settler colonial environmental knowledge. Taking my cues from recent work by Penny Olson, Lynette Russell, Shino Kanishi, Tiffany Shellam, Maria Nugent, Grace Karskins, the list goes on. I started this project by trying to trace the ways that Indigenous knowledge was utilised in the settler colonial project of the Geological Survey. To my initial frustration, I found that there wasn't much knowledge transferred or trace. By stepping back from Clark and his official writings and correspondence and looking into his informants, men like Charles Pleydell Wilton in The Hunter, I found traces, but nothing like that which took place during earlier periods of exploration and surveying. Shedding light, I realised, on the distinction between topographic and stratigraphic projects, there were in fact limits to the incorporation of pre-colonial knowledge within this settler project of environmental transformation and resource extraction. I will suggest today that these limits existed because colonial geology was geared primarily toward desacralisation. And by the middle of the 19th century, it was well equipped to advance it. In colonial New South Wales, where environmental adjustment obviously involved Indigenous dispossession, the uneven accrual of natural knowledge became an instrument of settler occupation. As the topographical project transitioned into a stratigraphic one during the middle of the 19th century, colonial geologists processed sacred Aboriginal geographies into extractive ones by distancing traditional occupants and construing their territory in terms of its broader value as a mineral or pastoral frontier. And this process, whereby places were simultaneously reframed in intellectual terms by the discipline of geology and remade in material terms through resource extraction, is what I'm referring to in my title, Landscaping Eastern Australia. But how did surveyors affect landscape change in a moment of shifting intellectual, material, and environmental conditions? And what was Clark's role in accounting for this new earth for geology? Born in Suffolk in 1798, William Bramwhite Clark first encountered inductive geological thinking at Jesus College, Cambridge, where he took classes with Adam Sedgwick, Woodwardian Professor of Geology. In many ways, he was primed to begin accounting for environmental change from this point. Not only did Clark forge a strong connection with Sedgwick, one of the dominant figures of early 19th century geology, but he also conducted fieldwork in the sinking, sponging, rising, ever-changing, increasingly drained fens. In such conditions, Clark's early training and experiences must have reinforced how geological forms of knowing were, as the British historian Patrick Joyce notes, temporary captures of knowledge and material agency. Importantly, such knowledge was also dynamic and contingent. Clark explicitly acknowledged these features in an 1851 guide to the Antipodean gold diggings, where he argued that the rush hinged on the prior example of California, which had prepared the public mind for Edward Hargrave's announcement of gold in New South Wales. Local knowledge mattered too, and Clark relied heavily on the insights of others. His commentary on the distant gold fields around the Gilbert River, for example, was predicated on his correspondence with locals and on the projection of his own knowledge of other auriferous sites. Much like Sedgwick back in Cambridge, natural knowledge swirled and congealed around Clark, whose patronage of surveyors and scientists across the colonies generated a return of information that secured settler control. In colonial New South Wales, geology then became a conduit through which ideas about environmental change flowed alongside assessments of earth history and reactions to encounter. Between the first acts of settler incursion into Eora country on the edges of the Sydney Basin in 1788 to the establishment of Wilkinson's survey in January 1875, Eastern Australia was involved in a rolling environmental crisis. Successive waves of settler incursion reshaped the delicate ecologies that Indigenous people had fine-tuned over many thousands of years. And in this context of epochal environmental change, geologists and surveyors produced new ideas about the earth that were dynamic, vulnerable, and provisional. Settlers wrestled, as Alison Bashford has explained, with a problem of periodizations. Surveying and geology had to mediate between the colonists' self-conscious historical time, the deep ecological and geological time of the Australian landscape, and sometimes the millennial timescales of Indigenous civilization. Those Antipodean colonists interested in climate, soil, rocks, and race were implicated in a coeval awakening to new human and earthly timescales, a discontinuity that Tom Griffiths argues compares to that of the discovery of the Americas in 1492. As all these elements took root in the Antipodes in the aftermath of 1788, they inflected the kind of natural knowledge that settlers assembled. In the field and in their studies, in offices and in parliamentary rooms, surveyors wrangled with shifting ecological, intellectual, and political orders. Their instrumental work in charting, describing, and historicising swathes of country along and beyond colonial frontiers eventually remade Eastern Australia. Over the better part of a century, surveys unevenly advanced the colonial order at the cost of prior Indigenous landscapes. Earlier topographical and cadastral surveys began this project, but geological surveys, which introduced new ways of thinking about surfaces in relation to the underground, accelerated them. In creating natural knowledge for the use of settlers, these men forged new avenues of dispossession, which is to say that geological surveying became an instrument of desacralization. By gradually remapping sacred geographies, agents of European scientific thinking produced imaginative landscapes within which various ways of knowing a place settled upon one another to form a unique settler colonial spatial order. Indeed, geological surveys were not really about finding and describing an objective reality, but about the creation and maintenance of new worlds for those who wielded power. Colonial geologists conducted their surveys according to these priorities, but shifts in the ideal use of particular landscapes unsettled their projects and forced reassessments. For instance, coal emerged as an abidingly important resource from about the 1830s. And while surveyors were always attentive to carboniferous deposits after this point, their focus was interrupted by rushes for gold and tin. Even after the institutionalisation of the New South Wales Geological Survey within the Department of Mines in 1875, surveyors had to balance waxing and waning interests in minerals with the expansive priorities of the pastoral economy. Surveys were also repeated for environmental reasons. In places where mineral rushes took place or graziers were too enthusiastic, whole ecologies could change markedly between one appraisal and another. Errors or oversights could necessitate new attempts to map territory or resources. Amateurs, professionals, geologists, and engineers could disagree over technical interpretations of places or simply overlook the work of their forebears. This was especially the case in New South Wales, where colonial society took a dim view of funding scientific work for over 60 years, and the fault lines between amateur, professional, and then academic science persisted into the 20th century. The reports, notes, letters, and articles that geologists like Clark produced as a result of their encounters with the field were artifacts of this dynamic context. They show how settlers related to the spaces around them, how they imagined the ones beneath them, and how they made use of geology to erect a hierarchy of uses. In their expeditions in the country around the Sydney Basin, the Australian Alps, and the slopes and plains west of the Great Dividing Range, Clark and his colleagues tested out the capabilities of a newly conceived model of Earth history. While earlier surveyors had documented the collision between an expanding settler system and older, more embedded ways of living and knowing, between the 1850s and the 1880s, the geological projects that drove Clark shifted the focus underground. In so doing, colonial geology accelerated environmental change in New South Wales and rendered past efforts to make sense of landscapes at least partially obsolete. William Bramwaite Clark emigrated to New South Wales in 1839 as a chaplain, nominated for the Society for the Propagation of the Gospel in Foreign Parts. He took control of the parishes of Castle Hill and Dural on the northern edge of the mostly flat, lightly wooded Cumberland Plain. The colonial establishment warmed to Clark almost immediately, no doubt impressed by the letters of introduction that he carried from his mentor Adam Sedgwick and the Scottish geologist Roderick Murchison. Writing to Sedgwick in 1840, Clark revealed that his dream was to do for Australia what you and Murchison have been doing for England. These hopes have led scholars like Anne Moyle to insist that Clark simply transferred the precepts of the experienced British geologist to Australia, just as the survey sciences were rapidly extended across the globe during the 19th century. But diffusion affected British practices, and Clark's work in Eastern Australia was more wide-ranging, less organised, only occasionally supported by the state, and always more fraught than the projects of Sedgwick and Murchison. Further, Clark was hardly the only geological thinker in the Antipodes, and although he was the best trained, he was by no means the first. Many settlers were involved in surveying the colony in various forms before Clark. Surveyor generals were a fixture within the colonial administration from 1788. And although they were often frustrated by lack of support, John Oxley and Thomas Mitchell both made topographic surveys of territory that Clark would later revisit. During the 1840s, Clark embarked on a number of personally funded expeditions designed to chart the extent of the Sydney and Hawkesbury sandstones, the carboniferous deposits below them, and the neighbouring formations in the Illawarra, the Hunter Valley, and the Blue Mountains. These expeditions added depth to colonial topographies and approximated those that Sedgwick and Murchison carried out themselves in the 1820s and 1830s in Scotland, France, southern England, and Wales. Clark understood himself as the descendant of these men and the figure through which a geological survey in the Antipodes could be established. Mounting a campaign through Sedgwick, Clark was ignored until 1849, when the first official non-military survey of New South Wales was established amidst rumours of gold. Interest in valuable metals was fueled by Clark, who in 1847, based on a familiarity with work in Russia's Ural Mountains, predicted that auriferous sands would be found in large quantities west of the Great Dividing Range. Despite this, the colonial government initially overlooked Clark and appointed the well-travelled English naturalist and geologist Samuel Stutchbury. However, after the beginning of a rush in New South Wales in May 1851, which was only a few months after Stutchbury began his geological and mineralogical survey in January, Clark too was enlisted by the colonial secretary. Whereas Stutchbury headed due west of Sydney into the heart of New South Wales gold country, Clark was allowed to draw up his own itinerary, consisting of surveys of the two large tablelands in the north and south of the colony. The Surveyor General, Thomas Mitchell, was also enlisted to carry out a small survey in the central west, but it mostly fell to Stutchbury and Clark to begin a new wide-ranging mineralogical and geological survey. An intense period of landscape apprehension and geological study followed in 1852 and 1853. Stutchbury essentially tracked north from the central goldfields while Clark traversed the Australian Alps, the Monero and the South Coast, then the northern tablelands of the New England and finally the Darling Downs in what is now southern Queensland. The first two trips were in search of gold. In the Alps, Clark was frustrated by the geography and the conditions, but drawing on narrow-gauge information about a golden mountain, still managed to identify 95 auriferous sites. In the New England, he encountered a region much richer in gold and tin. Further north in the Darling Downs, Clark found himself in another sedimentary basin, similar to Sydney. And reliably enough, the geologist discerned the existence of an enormous carboniferous formation that stretched well into the interior of the colony. These northern studies in particular had a significant impact in the 60s and 70s, when new surveyors were drawn into the area based on Clark's old maps. On his part, Stutchbury examined 32,000 square kilometres, an area the size of Austria, west of Clark's tablelands and further north into the tropics. In just a few years, Clark and Stutchbury turned a topography into a geology. There were new depths here, new dimensions, a new world of possibilities. Now, this work opened up possibilities for extraction, but it failed to deliver any systematic authority over landscapes until about the 1880s. Throughout this period, geologists themselves were often frustrated by the need to reconstruct topographical maps on the horizontal plane, rather than establish their own orders of stratigraphy on the vertical. They also consistently ran up against the limits of scales that were designed for other geographies. These frustrations were amplified by the fact that amateurs continued to find a home in the Antipodean geological fraternity well into the 1870s. Accordingly, a range of different kinds of surveying took place based on practical or commercial, public, or even private aims and priorities. By 1875, though, fault lines had emerged between the old colonial survey and the new system of geological inquiry needed to support the developing colony. Clark wrote that gentlemanly science pursued through private independent travel and research had serious limits, which could only be surpassed through the pecuniary and official resources of the colonial government. Still, in 1876, Charles Wilkinson, the head of the new Permanent Geological Survey, complained about the ever-increasing expense of redrawing maps and traverses. But even this surveying was transformative. In the short term, rough studies drew populations into new areas and encouraged them to prospect and mine. But over longer timescales, incomplete surveys generated new investments in territory. Although it amounted to something less than systematic knowledge, the period of competitive remapping that began in the 1850s accelerated the transformation of environments across eastern Australia. Bound up in the rush for gold, the work of Clark and Stutchbury in the early 1850s has often been considered as at least a partial failure. Anne Moyle in particular has argued that as Hargraves promoted his auriferous finds, the prospect of an ordered mineralogical survey slipped further and further off the colonial agenda. But was this really a failure? If the purpose of the colonial survey was to accelerate environmental transformation, then the projects of the 1850s were a cardinal success. The fact that they took geologists into the field for a sustained period of time was pivotal because both Clark and Stutchbury identified substantial metalliferous and carboniferous areas for the first time. Ordered or not, the remapping of the underworlds of New South Wales and the concomitant re-evaluation of the territory above them changed the face of the colony and readied it for the introduction of new ways of environmental categorization and exploitation. The foundational value of mid-century surveying certainly made the work of Charles Wilkinson more influential. Before his appointment to the head of the New South Wales Geological Survey, Wilkinson worked in the Surveyor General's Department, where in 1873, he published reports on the tin-bearing country of the Northern Tablelands. Focusing on a chain of deposits around Inverell and Tinga, Wilkinson essentially confirmed and extended Clark's insights from the 1850s. Although Wilkinson's study coincided with building interest in tin and copper in the New England region, his endorsement resulted in a full-blown 20-year rush. All across eastern Australia, these events reordered landscapes by denuding vegetation, stripping alluvium, sluicing it into watercourses, and holding chemically infected sludge in dams. Bright pools and pale slurry heaps still define the country around Tinga as a result of these late 19th century mineral rushes. Indeed, Wilkinson's re-inscription of northern geology came at a crucial time because extractive systems were often vulnerable to shifts in labour or value. Confirming the extent of deposits allowed companies to invest more fully in the earth. Writing about the goldfields of the Central West this time in 1876, Wilkinson acknowledged that rushes took place on unstable terrain. Although the goldfields were materially permanent until extraction, of course, The mineral economy existed between this fact and commercial contingencies. Surveying the overworked diggings of the Central West, Wilkinson comforted investors. The prospects have been such to encourage the belief that with cheaper labour and more efficient appliances for extracting gold than are now in use, considerable tracts of auriferous ground now abandoned will at some time be profitably worked. And this logic still pertains. Indeed, one of Australia's largest gold mines, Newcrest Open Cut Cadia Hill, is located within the very area that Wilkinson surveyed for this early report. Ultimately, colonial geologists reinscribed their surveys in order to secure extractive economies and deliver settler dominion over and under landscapes. The first comprehensive geological map of New South Wales was finally produced in the wake of Wilkinson's initial half decade with the Geological Survey. Itself a result of the accumulation of geological and mineralogical knowledge of New South Wales, the makers gave due recognition to Clark's foundational fieldwork. These maps conveyed both the state of the mineral economy in the 1880s, as well as the character and extent of the geology of New South Wales. While the important coal measures of the Hunter River and Illawarra were clearly marked out in a suitable charcoal, skilled readers could push the map further and quickly discern, for example, the goldfields clustered along the edges of the bright red granite intrusions, or that the northern tin and copper mines were signaled by a pink expanse of porphyritic rock. In this sense, the map was a sedimentation of colonial knowledge about economic geology that spanned early and sustained interest in carboniferous deposits, the periodic explosion of investment in auriferous regions, and the latest rushes for other minerals and ores in the 1870s. the particular landscapes on this map and the places within them, Newcastle, Bathurst, Inverell, were repeatedly recast themselves throughout the middle of the 19th century as a result of the development of mineral economies and extractive industries. In the 1880s, they were tied together in new ways, in new colonial scales, in geological time, and in red and grey ink. Wilkinson and the Geological Survey redefined the colonial landscape for the first time as a synthetic geological whole. So Wilkinson's 1880 map of New South Wales was an artifact of a settler colonial imagination geared toward two priorities. For settlers, the document mapped the extraction, but it also situated them in time and place. Extraction relied upon the identification and exploitation of the earth, and the map guided settlers looking for coal or valuable minerals. The key linked bright red and pink colours to the igneous and metamorphic rocks that form the bedrock of the New England or the Central West. Sedimentary formations, equated for Clark and other geologists with deep time, were indicated in gentle lavender, peach and mint. This potent combination of what appears to be colonial instrumental and intellectual utility was relatively fresh. For much of the preceding century, surveyors relied heavily on Indigenous knowledge. Thomas Mitchell drew on a veritable legion of Indigenous guides. The Wiradjuri man John Piper accompanied Mitchell on expeditions along the Darling River and into Australia Felix in 1836, and again northwest into the interior of the continent in 1845 and 46. But in the course of these expeditions and others, the Surveyor General almost always travelled with local Indigenous guides. Samuel Stutchbury relied on Indigenous people as well throughout his studies in the 1850s. And Clark too often turned to Indigenous information during his surveys. This new geological work, though, accommodated few of the anthropological observations that so fascinated Mitchell. And as a result, the New South Wales Geological Survey and its precedents began to turn away from Indigenous knowledge in its published material. Over time, surveyors' encounters with bygone worlds deep within the strata and their evaluations of places on the surface took precedence, diminishing Indigenous geographies. Colonial surveying had traditionally drawn much of its power from growth, but at mid-century, this priority became central, if not all-encompassing. Geological time ordered different forms of extraction, which organised exploitation and provided colonial geology with momentum. Indeed, Clark first found evidence of gold in New South Wales when he followed coal seams west past the eastern watershed. Just as geological ordering had a momentum that pushed Clark to look for new minerals beyond coal, colonial society fed off the notion of growth. In the decade before Stutchbury and Clark's surveys were organised, New South Wales grew substantially. According to one of Clark's own almanacs, the land under cultivation increased from 125,000 acres in 1840 to 180,000 in 1849. Population in the colony almost doubled from 130,000 people to about 250,000. The volume of exports of wool tripled in this time, and while the value of meat exports almost doubled. Capital and goods still streamed in from overseas, which was reflected in the continued deficit between inward and outbound shipping, which remained around 5,000 tonnes in 1849, despite a reduction of two-thirds since 1840. These flows inflected the future that settlers imagined when they incurred into Indigenous territory or remapped spaces on the edge of colonial control. For Stutchbury and Clark, geology dealt in these predictions, forecasts, and speculations. Their reports and publications held on to an appearance of objectivity, yet were, in other ways, inseparable from fantasy. Clark's widely read 1851 treatise on gold in Australia, Plain Statements and Practical Hints, offers an instructive and influential example of how these settler fantasies linked race and resources. The book opens with a description of the startling discovery of gold in New California near Sacramento in 1848, but quickly moves to the early part of 1851, when another announcement was made of a rich and extensive gold field in the basin of the Macquarie in New South Wales. Thus, in a brief interval of 3 years, both shores of the Pacific have been exhibited as offering attractions of no common kind to the gold hunting speculations of the Anglo-Saxon family, Clark wrote. Clark and his avid readers were dazzled by the prospect of golden futures, but the geologists were learning that the southern earth held all kinds of treasures. By 1876, Wilkinson was reporting to the Department of Mines that he was convinced that the mineral wealth of New South Wales was practically inexhaustible. For Wilkinson, settlers in New South Wales only required population and capital to realise and take advantage of these great resources. Like much of Wilkinson's work in the 1870s, this report advanced and consolidated Clark's positions on the geology of Eastern Australia, including his conviction that a bright white future awaited any settler who could extract valuable materials from the colonial earth. Colonial imaginaries were often concerned with the future, but geologists also forced settlers, obviously, to reconsider the past. Surveyors played important roles in introducing new visions of environments, connecting the deep past with the near future. Visions involved accounts of the formation of valuable minerals or deposits, but in Eastern Australia, they were also enlisted to desacralise more unavailing or prosaic geographies. In the early 1840s, for example, Clark published an essay on the geological history of the southern part of the Cumberland Plain that extended a settler colonial scientific imagination into the deep past. Although some coal deposits existed along the western edge of the plain, Clark's attention was drawn to the eastern edge, where an elevation of older volcanic origin, known by Pemulwuy's Bidjigal clan as Waimalee and by the colonists as Prospect Hill, took the form of a series of hills. Here, Clark read the rocks of Waimalee to construct a geological history of the site and its volcanic neighbours at Bulls Hill, Toongabie and St Mary's. He explained how basalt first emerged at Greystanes and flowed west and north from the eruption, how these flows cooled in situ, and how all of the sedimentary, metamorphic and volcanic masses have degraded over millennia. Around the ridges that were quarried for Sydney's roads in the early 19th century and in the hilltop depression that was inundated for the colony's first major reservoir in 1888, Clark turned to a deep time terra nullius that focused on pre-human geological processes. This particular approach may have diminished Indigenous histories, but figures like Clark were nevertheless drawn back to the space between the apparent antiquity of the Australian landscape and the characteristics of Indigenous civilization. Historians of other colonial sites like Saul DeBow and Pratik Chakrabarty have explained how this intellectual problem drew in scientists and adventurers alike in places like South Africa and India, where a convergence or a confluence of fields worked to link geology, ethnology, archaeology, and geography. In South Africa, this knowledge provided a basis for systematic racism, and in India, it aided in the consolidation of industrial resources. And intrepid mappers like Clark and Stutchbury back in Australia regularly found themselves in important Indigenous sites during their early studies or during the gold surveys of the 1850s. Clark acknowledged many of the original names of places, Waimalee, Bolaruk, Bangalaba, even though he failed to attach them to stories, practices, or histories of use. Other surveys played this differently. While mapping the country around Gladstone in 1854, Stutchbury encountered a Greng-Greng quarry on the slopes of Mount Tom. Among the flinty slate, Stutchbury observed that he was standing in a place much resorted to for the purpose of procuring a stone of sufficient durability for the manufacture of hatchets called by the locals Mogo. For geologists, unlike later antiquaries like Victoria's Stone Circle or Tasmania's Ernest Westlake, the disclosure of Indigenous information, though, was secondary to the description and measurement of resources. Clark's commitment to original naming was probably just an ornamentation, and Stutchbury's inclusion of the Greng-Greng quarry was a curiosity in the list of resources and measurements that he sent back from Gladstone. Mid-century surveyors were clearly not quite sure how to include Indigenous information in a landscape context, but their mapping mentalities offer further kind of possibilities for reading complex objects. Geological surveys enabled colonial development in material and imaginative ways, but their accumulations also must have enclosed different layers of knowledge. As settlers followed Indigenous paths, cooperated with local groups, and eventually usurped Aboriginal resources, They unwittingly preserved these histories. Certain cartographic representations could shed these knowledges. Clark's mappings ranged from tiny matchbook-sized notebooks filled with rough scribbles, transections, and stratigraphies, to his triumphant sketch map of New South Wales, which Wilkinson and the Department of Mines finally formalised in 1893. Now, it's notable that the kind of information about Indigenous society and culture that occasionally appeared in notebooks and survey reports rarely made it into these representations of the colonial earth. In its most synoptic form, the colonial geological imagination had no space for alternative Indigenous territorialities. By omitting information about Indigenous occupations, surveyors created spaces where extraction could advance unimpeded by the possibility of Indigenous possession or even ongoing white settlement. Although colonial governments frequently expressed a commitment to what Australian historians call closer settlement, vast swathes of territory in eastern Australia were subjected to a form of wide-ranging extractive agriculture throughout the middle of the 19th century. Unsurprisingly, surveyors were enlisted in the development of this industry. Stutchbury, for instance, concluded his report on the Port Curtis district with an assessment of the country for pastoral extraction and development. He observed that the banks of the Fitzroy present excellent sites for farms. The land is rich and well grassed with an abundance of fresh water. These prospects even distracted Stutchbury from the gold, which William Wiseman and Richard Daintree reported on later in the century. Geographical observations like these articulated with geological assessments in ways that encouraged pastoral extraction. In both the far north, where Stutchbury encountered promising river valleys, and in the original site of settler expansion, the Cumberland Plain, new understandings of deep history fed into agricultural development. Clark's investigation of Prospect Hill, for example, explained how the southwestern slope of the hill furnishes a rich soil for the vineyard at Veterans Hall, and suggested that similar metamorphic histories would result in the same insights elsewhere. In an indication of how closely the survey was tied up with agricultural development in New South Wales, Clark was in correspondence with many pastoralists who passed on local knowledge in exchange for technical expertise about soils, drainage, and weather. For Charles Wilkinson, surveying and pastoral extraction was fraternal. His brother-in-law was Robert Bliss, a pastoralist and stock and station agent in Balranald in New South Wales's southwestern districts. In the process of extracting value from the environment, these operations relied on the insights of the survey, but they also incorporated Indigenous labour and knowledge. Pastoralists combined this knowledge with the technical insights of geologists in order to transform sacred earth into profitable commodities like wool and flesh. These connections between Indigenous dispossession, pastoral expansion, mineral extraction, and colonial surveying essentially date to the middle of the 19th century. At mid-century, scientists and pastoralists realised that abundant colonial coal could lift their fortunes substantially. Even studies that cast doubt over the extent of deposits under the original site of settlement on the rich Cumberland Plain refused to discourage further subterranean exploration. The authors of an 1841 report on the Australian coalfields hoped that they had underestimated the deposits under Sydney, as the value of coal to the colony is incalculable, and the discovery of it in abundance in available situations will do more to advance Australia than all the political institutions with which the ingenuity or iniquity of man can devise. From about this time, settlers saw few tensions between ongoing agriculture and mineral extraction. That settlers and pastoralists mostly understood the encroachment of extractive industries in an autonomous way is partly due to the small scale of late 19th century Australian mining. Coal in particular was mostly for local use, and its export failed to warrant a mention in any of Clark's mid-century almanacs. For most pastoralists, the extraction of carboniferous rocks could be neatly absorbed into a vision of picturesque coexistence. This series of 1873 engravings accompanying an article on the deposits of iron, coal, and kerosene show how extractive projects could sit within local landscapes, even though anxieties about development and despoliation were well aired by this time. This approach to extraction was also supported, crucially, by geological thinking. Clark's own work in the service of mineral extraction normalised a perspective that considered agriculture and mining as complementary responses to antipodean nature. He opened his 1875 remarks on the sedimentary formations of New South Wales with a geomorphological history of Eastern Australia. Here he explained how the Great Dividing Range had shaped sedimentary carboniferous and sandstone formations, how granitic uplift created the auriferous veins of the tablelands, and how the denudation of soil forged the productive valley ecologies of the East Coast. In works like this, and in the surveys that Clark's colleagues produced throughout the middle of the 19th century, geological time ordered different forms of extraction that might otherwise have developed in tension. Although the work of geologists meant that prospectors and investors could be more confident about the position and extent of deposits, a moving sense of incommensurability prevailed in the popular presentation of knowledge about the earth. An 1869 almanac in Clark's collection, for example, maintained that despite knowing much about the positioning of the coal deposits vis-a-vis the valuable gold-bearing auriferous schists, the age of the coal seams has not been determined with certainty, despite the researches of several geologists. Like many other products of the Antipodean Earth, these minerals may have presented many analogies with northern strata, while differing from them in puzzling ways. Perhaps so, but geologists in the field were happy to land on specific dates. 15 years before the publication of the almanac in 1854, Samuel Stutchbury supported Clark and argued that the Antipodean coals were slightly older than the European measures. For him, other features of the Australian landscape remained incommensurable. It was impossible to prove, Stutchbury wrote, at what geological epoch the enormous tracts of pyrogenous rocks of the Glasshouse Mountains emerged, for example, but coal could be positioned with some certainty. One explanation for this kind of incommensurable geopoetics is that it allowed for the continued projection of growth as an aesthetic choice in compliance with the settler imagination, or even as a problem within colonial science. Incommensurability left the door open for new discoveries, new commodities, and new opportunities for world making. So in his study of the high plateau east of the Snowy Mountains discovering Monero, the historian Keith Hancock observed that the discovery of Australia or of any Australian region is not a once for all achievement, but rather a continuing effort whose end, if there ever is an end, still lies far beyond sight. For Hancock, as for Clark, this sentiment related to the deep mystery of a place that was at once familiar and foreign. In our current era, however, this notion of incommensurability takes on an additional valence. In the Anthropocene, an era fueled by the carboniferous rocks that so fascinated Clark and his colleagues in the mid-19th century, we are all struck by the instability of natural knowledge, the shifting parameters of measurement, and the rapidly changing conditions of the material world. Here and now, it is clear that not only could surveyors only apprehend an object from their perspective, but that the very object of their study, the natural world, was unstable. Such contemporary insights reframe the experience of those settlers who trekked across a rapidly changing Eastern Australia during the mid-19th century. As the manifest ecological changes of the settler revolution unfolded across a third of a continent, surveyors set out to reckon with this new environmental set of conditions with pencil, chain, and theodolite. In a way that had profound costs, surveys reported on these environmental conditions with a sense of incommensurability and opportunity. The construction of natural knowledge on this basis set off a kind of feedback loop that reshaped local ecologies as it diminished the ancestral connections between Indigenous people and the land. In Eastern Australia, these feedback loops compounded settlement, advanced pastoralism and extraction, and created new avenues of profit. Settlers managed to avoid the full implications of waves of landscape change, perhaps until now, by continually reassessing territory and reworking their surveys to develop new economies. Geologists knew themselves that the forces they were unleashing were powerful and unpredictable. Reflecting on the multiple purposes and pathways of natural knowledge, Clark reminded his readers that even if our expectations be found hereafter of less real importance than has been assigned to them, the matter is not without results of another kind. As I've demonstrated today, the scientific and cartographic projects designed to apprehend the colonial environment throughout the middle of the 19th century struggle to keep pace with environmental change and settler anticipation. In this context, the notion of geological time emerged as a helpful anchor for thinkers who were repeatedly asked to explain the conditions of the natural world in this unstable place. Ironically enough, this led to an attachment to incommensurability and an openness to future possibilities that we might describe as a peculiar colonial geopoetics. That this form of wonder emerged from and in concert with Indigenous dispossession in the Antipodes should trouble emerging attachments to the geological sublime. Many of the stories of making and unmaking that the nature writer Robert McFarlane offers us as balm for the quick greeds and furies of the present were too often attached to injustice and impatience. Indeed, in Eastern Australia, deep histories have been used to accelerate ecological crisis and identify opportunities for settler expansion. Infused with the spatial and racial dreams of a young colony and fueled by the material abundance of value in the earth, the scattered fragments of the geological survey created the very conditions for environmental change. Here, figures like Clark, Stutchbury, and Wilkinson inscribed, revised, and re-inscribed their maps of deep time in ways that encouraged prospectors and pastoralists to move into new geographies and create fresh changes. In turn, these transformations drew more surveyors into the field on new projects of geological world-making, intensifying settler control over the past and the future of New South Wales. Thank you.
Thank you for that. One of the real pleasures of these Scholar Talk series is you actually get a real insight into the labour that goes into this type of archival research that our fellows do. So thank you for exemplifying that it's hard work, but obviously great rewards. So we do have a couple of questions coming through. We have a lot of people saying thank you. Somebody's talking about your use of the word exploitation. So you said that several times this morning, and it does seem to be almost that they couldn't see much else, especially in those early years, to the point where it was extract everything and almost leave. Do you have that sense of what they thought the future might hold once they'd gone into these areas?
Yeah, certainly. It's one of the senses that you get in a lot of these kind of, but both the survey reports are kind of very instrumental in the sense that they describe resources and kind of give some indication of how they may be used most effectively. But most effectively at that point did not kind of admit any sense of sustainability. What's interesting about Clark's archive is then he then collects all of these newspaper cutoffs that kind of report back to him, say in the 30 odd years after he does his gold surveys, about the areas that he reports on in the 1850s and the 1860s. And so you can read the survey reports of Clark, but then kind of if you go through the newspaper clippings that he assiduously collects, it gives a sense of kind of what's happening in those areas. And almost all the time, it's kind of a cycle of boosters drawing people into an area. You know, Tinga might be a good example. And then kind of some complaint about the collapse of the rush or about the damages that's happening to the environment. But I mean, you know, the priorities here in each of these sites have been, you know, at this point anyway, have been to kind of, yeah, exploit the resources and move on to another promising site.
It's sort of a little bit depressing that we don't necessarily learn from some, I mean, if we were creating that sort of damage so early on and to not immediately be thinking about remediation, which is what the next person is asking about online. They're saying, thank you very much. So interesting to look at some of those stories, you know, like those survey maps would be familiar in outline, if not those specific maps, to so many of us. You know, we see them in books, we've seen them here at the library, but those really complicated stories that sit behind them. So this question that's coming in now is one of the fun questions of history and the personalities that drive some of these stories. So the men that you've discussed today, was there a lot of competition that you saw about who was able to go in what direction and whether people had to retread areas that had been surveyed by somebody else, whether they think, oh, well, I can just go in there and do it better, or whether they really wanted to go somewhere that no colonists had actually ventured to before?
I hope I'm not getting this wrong, but I think famously Clark and Mitchell did not get on very well, but I don't think Mitchell got on with very many people at all. So there's that. One of the interesting things about Wilkinson, which is kind of was an unexpected place that I ended up during this fellowship. I kind of, you know, initially just wanted to look into Clark, but then I ran into Wilkinson because he seemed to be going back over Clark's grounds a lot in the 1870s. One of the interesting things about Wilkinson is that he doesn't actually seem all that bothered by Clark's work. I don't know whether that's about his respect for Clark as a patron, because Clark becomes a very influential man in Australian science by the late 19th century. So that could be the case, but that didn't seem to stop a lot of other people whinging about, you know, certain surveys that people had done. So there doesn't seem to be a lot of competition between Wilkinson and Clark, which is one of the interesting things. I think that might be to do with the institutional assurance that Wilkinson gets when he becomes the head of the survey. But certainly in the early era, there is a huge degree of competition. Mitchell is obviously a great example of that. But Clark is very unhappy when Stutchbury gets appointed to the survey before he does. And, you know, I would say that he might have been relieved when the rush proved to be so all-encompassing that they needed two surveyors to do the work. But I think he was probably just happy enough to get out and do some surveying with some support.
Somebody's asking about the dangers of Zoom and losing your screen. So somebody's asking about the view that agriculture and pastoralism could easily coexist with mineral extraction. And they're going on to say that the symbolism in Newcastle of the Australian Agricultural Mining Company on Shepherd's Hill, which you would be familiar with, is resonant of this. I must say I have found that the coal mining and associated smoke and dust tended to dominate ideas about Newcastle, excluding other possibilities for the region. And so the question is, do you think that Newcastle example is an exception to that rule?
I actually had a long bit on that Australian Agricultural Company that I've cut out of this. It is an interesting example because the AA Co kind of diversifies in some ways into mining quite early. I think it's very early. It's not up there anymore. You know, there are sketchings from surveyors that work for the AA Co that show the coal exporting facilities, the rudimentary coal exporting facilities that develop there early on. I think things certainly change in Newcastle. That may be an exception, particularly in the Hunter Valley. But I suppose the other thing that I kind of was struck with the AA Co is that, you know, the AA Co is not just Newcastle, it's the other valleys up the coast. And while extraction and its costs, I think, are quite clear in Newcastle, they're quite easily kind of expanded into other pastoral geographies in different places.
And that is actually all we have time for today. Please join us next time. So Scholar Talks at 11 on a Tuesday morning will continue. Our next speaker is Dr. Georgia McQuinney. She was a visiting scholar here at the library a couple of years ago, and she'll be talking about her doctoral research and how soldiers came up with their own ways to medicine in themselves and each other. So do tune in for that. We have the History Matters series tomorrow at 5:30 p.m. celebrating women's history. And watch out on the library's website too for a new public program, Scholar Talks at 6, evening talks by scholars here on site to celebrate the library's new maps rooms, which will be opening soon. Until then, stay safe. And if I don't see you here at the library, I hope to see you online very soon. Thank you for coming.